Hachette Audio presents American Scary, a history of horror from Salem to Stephen King and beyond. Written by Jeremy Dauber. Read by Jeremy Dauber. Note to listeners, there are references to graphic violence, sexual content, suicide, child abuse, rape, blood and gore, and other content in this audiobook, which listeners may find disturbing. Introduction. Red, white, and black. Show me what scares you, and I'll show you your soul. It goes for nations, too, not just people. You can write America's history by tracking the stories it tells itself to unsettle its dreams, rouse its anxieties, galvanize its actions. Sometimes those stories are flickering on the screen of a darkened movie theater. Sometimes they're printed on the well-thumbed pages of a massive paperback novel with the author's name embossed on the cover. Sometimes they're told around campfires by scout leaders. And sometimes they're in the teasers for your local News at 11 or in tweets that go viral, embers of concern fanned into flame. What I'm going to do here is tell you the American horror story from its earliest days to our current nightmares. Our guiding light is the not-so-simple question simply put. What scared the crap out of us? Telling that story means taking in Puritan preachers' threats of eternal damnation and Jordan Peele's tales of demonic racism and most everything in between. Household names like Stephen King, Ryan Murphy, and Shirley Jackson, next to horror fan favorites like Robert Bloch, Kathy Koja, and Robert Eggers. Pulp magazines and comic books like Weird Tales and Tales from the Crypt, side by side with Nathaniel Hawthorne, Henry James, Edith Wharton. Classic writers who made no bones about working these veins, so to speak. All side by side, because the history of American horror, like any cultural history, is that of links in a chain. Writers incorporating their predecessors' technical tricks and creative innovations in the art of scaring the bejesus out of their readers, then cranking it up a notch or playing it in their own chilling key. And how that music plays depends, of course, on the medium in which these tales of terror appear. Horror is like water. It seeps in everywhere, leaving things that grow dark and clammy in its wake. And so with every new movement, every new invention, the nationally syndicated newspaper, movies, the radio, television, the internet, the way the classic themes appear transforms, sometimes dramatically, sometimes softly, sometimes monstrously. And that's part of the story, too. Story, singular, because at its dark heart, American horror, for all its variety, despite the stamp of differing times and places and approaches, comes down to a fear with two faces. What's a horror story without an uncanny double, after all? And almost everything we'll see in our story sups of or shuttles between the two of them. The first, the fear of something grand, something cosmic. Whether it's an angry god that consigns sinner to the fire and brimstone, or Lovecraft's creatures from out of space and time, or the ticking time bomb of global warming, we, as humans, are constantly trying to bat away the specter of our own ultimate insignificance. And one flavor of horror reminds us of our fragility and, often, our failure to transcend it. Its geography is a map of thin places, locations where the veil between the world we live in and another one entirely is slender, where these reminders pop up with teeth. Places like Shirley Jackson's Hill House, where no mind can long stay sane, and Stephen King's Derry, where it prowls the sewers with balloons and claws, two 20th century examples from a long blood-stained list. The other fear is the flip side of the first. It's the monster located right next door. Fear of the other, constantly present, constantly malleable, is our second great thread. And we'll trace it as it swirls and cycles around most of the traditionally frightening cards in the American deck. Indigenous tribes, black people, immigrants, and always, always women, witches and sirens painted as emasculators in so many different stripes. All reminding the audience of the ugly monster that lies within themselves. From the monstrous double of Poe's William Wilson to Penn Badgley's Netflix serial killer series, titled simply, You. Not to be confused with Jordan Peele's 2019 meditation on the horror double, called Us. As far back as Aristotle, horror fiction, and What's Greek Tragedy If Not a Catalog of Horror, has been understood as a way of taking your fears for a walk, playing them out on the amphitheater stage, purging them as you emerged blinking into the light. Catharsis, in other words. And there's no better recipe for it than the allegories of fearsome fiction, where real terrors play themselves out in impossible settings. But that's not the whole story, is it? Sure, we'll track how monstrous symbols shift and blur over the centuries, how the zombie moves from colonialist critique to racist call-out to consumerist satire to epidemiological echo, how the vampire can speak to both crumbling empires and the AIDS epidemic, how the alien from outer space can be a communist missile or a Christian allegory, or sometimes even both at once. But we need to cut deeper, too, closer to home. Not just fictional material that speaks to American reality in disguise, albeit often not a terribly good disguise, that Halloween mask sometimes slips a bit, or a lot. We'll see a lot of true horror stories, too. Like the unconventional 19th century bed and breakfast where people checked in, but didn't check out. And the murder castle located just a few miles from a World's Fair, and the Lonely Hearts murderer, and the Plainfield ghoul, which, in turn, influenced some of the most important American horror fiction ever made, and many, many more. Because, in the end, all we have are the stories. Hundreds of them. New delights, old favorites, that fit together into a long and not always distinguished story, which I hope you'll think about when you're all alone. Chapter 1. In the Hands of God and the Devil. Our story begins, like all good horror stories should, in the dark. The northeastern part of the land that would eventually become known as the United States of America was covered in woods, deep dark woods, a natural setting for tales told by firelight. Those who walked those woods for centuries, those whose lands they were, had their explanations for the shadows that multiplied at the edges of their campfires, and tales of the creatures that dwelled within those shadows. Much of that rich and varied folklore was, and often remains, orally transmitted. And though assuredly certain details have altered and evolved over the years, and tales differed from tribe to tribe, the rich interchange between tribal cultures and the overlapping landscape and milieu that many of the tribes shared allowed an overarching set of themes and characters to emerge. Not all those tales were tales of fear, but some of them were. Some, like those of the Algonquian nation's savage Wendigo, seem to us to be the transmogrification of the natural landscape, of the ravening beasts that would hunt were they not hunted. Others, like tales of Coyote, the trickster or snake, or Iktomi, the spider, partake of the universal concern that the gods and creatures greater than ourselves were hardly beneficent, but could, should the occasion arise and their quasi-cosmic amusement persist, see fit to be swayed for a time, at least. But what persists, perhaps most, is the sense of the land, of its balance between bounty and blight, between kindness and horror, its promise and potential. The men and women who landed on those shores in the 17th century, those who came by choice at least, are often characterized by their hopes and dreams of new worlds and shining cities on a hill, and this is true enough, but, and to our point, they were also shrouded in fear. As refugees, whether by necessity or in their own self-conception doesn't matter much for the state of mind we're discussing, they brought with them a world they felt was steeped in devilishness, witchery, and diabolism. Most of those sailing from England across the Atlantic in the 17th century wouldn't have held much truck with the theater. More precisely, they considered it a hotbed of heresy, scandal, and obscenity run riot. But had they ventured to the theater in the two decades before those first ships set sail, they might have encountered a brace of works that sum up for us fundamental aspects of that worldview. "I, heaven, will be revenged of every ill, nor will they suffer murder unrepaid," Hieronymo says in Thomas Kidd's late 16th century Spanish tragedy. And that sense of violent consequence marked the revenge play then in fashion. The ghost of a murdered man and the allegorical spirit of revenge are constantly on stage. And when the dead bodies litter the stage at the end, the ghost remarks, "Aye, these were spectacles to please my soul." His soul, not heaven's desire, one might suspect, and not just his. When the bad bleeds, then is the tragedy good, goes a line in The Revenger's Tragedy, published a decade later, and wrapping lust for violence and gore in a cloak of piety to please the very human demands of a bloodthirsty audience will hardly be unfamiliar to modern-day moviegoers. By the time The Revenger's Tragedy appeared, Elizabeth I had died, and King James VI of Scotland headed south to become King of England, first of his name. And the United Kingdom's new monarch was passionately interested in the magical and maleficent, having authored a book, Demonology, on the subject.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.